to help conserve an ecosystem, we need to have a better understanding of its habitats. We can carry out an ecological study of a habitat to study how abiotic factors affect the distribution and abundance of different species in the habitat. From the data obtained, we can deduce the possible relationship among different species and the patterns of energy flow and material cycling in the habitat. So, how do we find the distribution and abundance of organisms in the habitat? It is impossible to find the distribution and abundance of organisms in the habitat by counting every individual organism, because their number and the area of the habitat are usually very large. Sampling therefore becomes necessary. There are two main types of sampling strategies, random and systematic. Let's look at some sampling methods commonly used in ecological studies. The first equipment that we can talk about is the quadrat. A quadrat is a square framed enclosing a fixed area, often of 0.25 or 1 meter squared. It can be used for random sampling to estimate the abundance of plants, immobile or fairly slowly moving organisms in a habitat. Last, biosphere. Biosphere refers to the entire space on Earth's surface where organisms exist. It consists of the land, the water. To make the estimation more reliable, it is necessary to carry out repeated sampling and calculate a mean value. Although quadrats are easy to use, they have a number of limitations. First, quadrats cannot be used to sample fast-moving organisms. Secondly, the size of the organisms must be small enough so that a reasonable number of individuals is enclosed by the quadrat. And third, quadrats can be used alone only when the habitat is fairly uniform. The second tool we can use is the transect. A transect is a piece of inelastic string with markings at 1 meter intervals. It is commonly used for systematic sampling. It is useful for recording changes in abundance and distribution of species in habitats when some sort of transition occurs. For example, the distribution pattern of different species along a rocky shore or a mangrove. Let's look at two common ways to use a transect. First, it is the line transect. In the line transect method, a transect is placed along a specific direction where changes in population and abiotic factors under study are identified. For example, a transect can be placed along the slope of an area of grassland or from the upper shore towards the lower shore of a mangrove area. A distribution graph can be drawn to show individuals touching the transect. This method is most suitable for studying the range of distribution of a species in the habitat. However, it shows only the presence or absence of species. It cannot show the abundance of different species. And therefore, we can use the second method, the belt transect. To obtain a more reliable estimation of the distribution and abundance of certain species in the habitat, the belt transect method can be used. This method allows us to study the abundance of a certain species at different points along the line, as well as its range of distribution in relation to specific environmental conditions. In the belt transect method, a transect is laid down along the area to be studied, and quadrats are placed continuously or at fixed intervals on one side of the transect. The positions of the quadrats and the organisms enclosed by the quadrats are recorded. The data can be presented using a kite diagram. What about the abiotic factors? How can we measure abiotic factors in the habitat? Various instruments can be used to collect data about abiotic factors in ecological studies. With advances in technology, data loggers have been developed. A data logger can log data from different sensors. The data is displayed in a small screen on the data logger. The data can be plotted into graphs in real time. This has greatly facilitated data collection and presentation in ecological studies. The relationship of ecology to Chinese mitten crabs. Chinese mitten crabs are omnivores, eating both plants and animals. Juvenile crabs eat primarily vegetation. As they mature, the crabs increasingly prey on animals, including worms and clams. However, predatory fish, including sturgeon, striped bass, and channel catfish, as well as bullfrogs, raccoons, river otters, and wading birds may prey upon the crab. Since Chinese mitten crabs live in fresh water but require salt water to successfully reproduce, they are being recognized as catadromous, which means migrating down rivers to the sea to spawn. These crabs are commonly found in estuaries, intertidal areas, marshes, rice fields, lakes, rivers, and creeks, where they can have easy access to both conditions. Furthermore, as you have just learnt from the nitrogen cycle in this chapter, let's look at how nitrogen cycle works in aquaponics. Nitrogen cycle is important when we are dealing with an aquaponic system, especially the following three steps, namely ammonification, nitrification, and assimilation. In an aquaponic system, the crabs provide nutrients for the plants, and the plants help clean the water for crabs. Let's look at how it works. For ammonification, the crabs excrete waste which contains ammonia into the water. With nitrification, the bacteria converts ammonia to nitrate and further converts it to nitrate. After ammonia is converted to nitrate, plants absorb nitrate in assimilation. As a result, nitrogen compounds which are toxic to fish are converted to nutrients that helps the plants to grow. This is the end of the video. Thank you for watching. Please give us a like and subscribe to our channel. We'll see you next time. Bye-bye.